You then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with Him in glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil conspicuousness, and covetous, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God comes on the children of disobedience, in which you also walked some time when you lived in them. But now you also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of Him who created him. Amen. Let's ask the Lord's blessing tonight. Father, we thank You, Lord, for everything that You do in our lives. And Father, we just ask, oh God, if there's anything in our lives that would hinder tonight, if there's anything, Lord, that would hinder Your Word tonight, hinder Your peace, Your thoughts, Lord, we ask You would forgive us of it. Any sin in our life, Lord, anything that we've done that is against You or contrary to You, and Father, we ask that You would forgive us. I pray that that's the prayer of everybody in this room tonight. Lord, we thank You for saving us. We give You the glory. We give You the honor. Lord, I'm just asking You to help us tonight. Help us with simple things, Lord, that goes to our heart. And Father, we'll thank You for it. And we'll ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, I've read this verse so many times in my Christian experience. If then ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. The book of Romans, in chapter number 5, begins to talk about this death that we have in Christ and this life that we have in Christ. When you and I come before God and we have placed our faith and our hope and our belief in Christ, who is the manifest image of God the Father, and we place our faith in what Christ has done on that cross, then when God begins to look at you and I in our faith in what Christ did on the cross for us, He sees you and I embodied into this death of Christ. In other words, Christ died for our sins. Christ died for the ungodly. Christ died for you and I when you and I could not be righteous. You and I could not be holy. God said, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." But yet that was impossible for any of us to accomplish. We were born in what is called original sin. When Adam fell, you heard me say it a couple of weeks ago whenever I was ministering to you that Eve was deceived in the garden, but whenever Adam sinned, he sinned openly. He sinned with the knowledge of knowing that he was not to do what God had warned him of. You notice something funny in the Bible that I've noticed over the years is that God didn't warn Adam about Satan. There's no record of that where God says, "Hey, you know, there's this boogerish feller that I've cast down here to the earth, and you got to watch him." You don't find God telling Adam that. God simply just commanded Adam not to partake of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He commanded him not to partake of that fruit. He didn't tell him why. He didn't tell him that there was this boogerish fella walking around the earth that was going to try to deceive them and try to... He just said, "Don't do it. Don't do it." He expected Adam and Eve to follow him and to obey him. And that's what he really demands out of us. That's what he asked you and I to do. And some people might say, "Well, listen, we live in the day of grace. It's much easier than the day of the law." Well, hey, not really. Because back then you had 10 big ones you had to watch out for. Now it's everything. Now you just walk along and the Holy Spirit says, "All right, Dwight, that ain't good. And about the time you get a handle on that, you say, Lord, we're good. Thank you, Jesus, for washing away my sins. And thank you, Jesus, for giving me the victory over that through the cross of Calvary. And I'm good. And you go along there for a couple of days, Tristan, and you think everything's going real good. And then all of a sudden the Holy Spirit shines that beam on your heart and says, well, here's something else that we need to deal with. You say, man, I just got victory over the other thing, and now you want something else? You see, God's looking for purity. He's looking for you and I to walk in Christ and to walk in that holiness, not of ourselves, but to be convicted of everything that would be against Christ. Yeah. Everything that would bring about bad witness, bad testimony, but anything that would hinder the work of God happening in your life. I love the concept that God is everywhere. I've been thinking so much about that in the past year. That God is everywhere. Now, I've always known that. I've heard preachers tell about that before I was even saved. Amen. They would say God is everywhere, and I believe that. But for the last year, it's become more real to me than anything I know of that the presence of God is with me and you 24 hours a day. It does not matter where we go, how far we run. We could dig a hole 100 miles into the center of the earth and God would be there with us.
Right. Amen.
David said, if I make my bed in hell, thou art there with me. Yeah. Jonah was in the belly of a great fish. I don't know if it was a whale. It might have been a big saltwater catfish for all you and I know. They tell me there's some the size of Volkswagens at Altoona Dam. I don't know what kind of fish, but not the kind of fish is important. It's what happened in the fish.
Yeah.
Is that Jonah was there and he was inside the great fish and he began to cry out to God. And God wasn't standing over on the bank somewhere saying, is he talking to me? Is that him I hear? No, he cried out to God from the very belly of that thing. Entombed in a grave inside of this great fish. And he cried out to God and God heard him. That's why I say there's no place that you can go. There's no place you can go hide. There's no place that you can seek refuge away from God when you're doing wrong, because He's there with you when you're doing wrong, just like He is when you're there doing right. And thank God for that. Thank God that I walked off into some places where I was doing wrong and God didn't stop at the door and say, I can't go in there. Thank God He went in there with me and He was tapping me on the shoulder.
Hallelujah.
And He was touching me in the heart and saying, get out of here. This is no place. It's no place for us. You're not seeking the things above. You're seeking the things below. That's really why we as Christians don't have any business putting anything that is worldly or ungodly in our spirit. Because we're not of this world anymore. We have nothing in this world anymore. We have no, as Jesus would say, Satan has nothing in me. And Satan has nothing in you. If you've been born again, if you've been bought by the blood of Jesus, if you've been saved, you don't have to worry about Slewfoot. You're a child of the King. You don't have to worry about waking up every day and fighting the devil off if you've been saved. You got an elder brother that's took care of him for you. You have the authority of Christ in your life. You have the ability of saying, hey, I'm a child of God. And even though Satan may be my enemy, he has nothing in me and he has no power over me.
Amen.
And the more we begin to realize this in our life, and the more we begin to place our faith in what Christ has done for us, and let that be the foundation of everything that we say, do, and believe, we'll find we have more victory in our life. We'll find we can walk through the valley and hold our head up, knowing that when we get out on the other side, we're going to be better for it. It just never gets no easier when you're a child of God. There's always a test. There's always a test. You know, it really breaks down to there's two forces in this world. Two forces in this world. There is the force of God. things which are above, the good of God, and that God is good. Amen? Would you agree with me now that God is good?
Yes, He is.
God's not bad. He's good all the time, ain't He, brother?
Yes, He is.
He's good. How many of you in here would believe that God is for you and not against you? Amen. Say it with me. God is for me. God is for me. He's for you. Amen. And God created this world. And I'm here to tell you that God is still the God of this world. He is not the God of this world system. There's a difference between this world system and this world. The mindset of this world is a fallen mindset. Have you ever noticed that it's so much easier to sin than it is to seem to live right? But a child of God, the answer for that is no. It's not, because it's easier to live right now. Because you're in the covenant. And you've got the power and you've got the ability to live for Him. Because Christ in you. Your hope and your glory. That's why Paul would say, greater is He that is in me than he that is in this world. In other words, there was something happening down on the inside of Paul that was greater than this world system. Bigger than this world system. God is still the God of this world. But Satan is the God of the world system. The way the world thinks. If God was the God of the world system, we wouldn't be fighting wars in foreign countries. There wouldn't be children starving, not because of lack of food, but because of governments.
Yes.
I remember years ago, back in the 80s, Jimmy Swaggart and them loaded up, I don't know how many tractor trailers of grain, and was taking it into a third world country to feed people. And the government hijacked that shipment of food and stole it. Not to feed people, but to feed a regime, to feed an army. Because an army was trying to come along with an idea that was contrary to freedom. And of course, I'm not going to wave the flag and play the Star Spangled Banner for you. But I will say that our idea of freedom comes from Judeo-Christian thought.
That's right. Our son is set free.
We've been made free by Christ.
Yeah.
Christ said in John 8:32, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen? Whew! We need air conditioning. Well, we need. Door flung open something. Y'all trying to kill us up here. Amen. But we've been made free by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And the world system, do you just begin to even think how we are so influenced in our life every day and bombarded in our life by the God of this world system. You can ride down the interstate and I guarantee you look at the billboards. Look at the billboards. What is trying to draw you in to buy, to purchase what it is that's up there? I mean, what does a naked woman have to do with buying a motorcycle or a car? What does it have to do with it?
Make you think you got one in this.
Make you a nut. But that's the way the world thinks. The world thinks attraction with the eyes. The world thinks that sex sells, and it does. But that's not God's plan. That's not the way God views life. That's not the way God views that we would have His very best. There's two forces in this world and they run contrary to each other.
Yes.
And it's constant. It's constant. This is how come that sin runs against the grain of who God is. And everything that he stands for and his truth. Because God is holy. God is pure. This is one of the reasons why that God could not deal with man in his sinful condition. This is how come if that high priest went into that holy of holies and he had the smallest taint of sin that hadn't been covered in the sacrifice, he would be stricken dead in the presence of God, because the presence of God knew no evil in his presence. And that Old Testament plan was God trying to get to man, having fellowship with man. And of course, Jesus comes along, the incarnate Christ, who is the very image of God the Father. They asked Jesus, they said, "Show us the Father." He said, "Oh, I've not been with you so long that you haven't seen the Father." In other words, if you've seen Jesus, you've seen the Father. You've seen who the Father is. Now, you and I can't see the Father. We see with spiritual eyes, but not with natural eyes. But if you would have been there in Galilee or there in Nazareth and you would have looked at the physical embodiment of Jesus, well, you would have been looking at the very expressed image of the Creator of all of heaven and earth. Everything that He was what God the Father was embodied. His, not in just a physical form, but in a thought process, in a heart, in a heart that was full of mercy and grace and wanting to reach out and to heal and to touch those that were sick, those who needed a physician. God's heart was to heal them. God's heart was to change them. Does His heart, is it diminished any today?
No.
It's still the same, isn't it? It's still the same heart. It's still the same heart of mercy. It's still that same idea that God wants to reach out to a lost world, to sinners, and that He wants to, I want to say, inform them. That's a bad choice of a word. But He wants to show them and tell them that He has provided a better way. That He has provided the way of salvation. That He has sent His Son to die upon the cross of Calvary to pay the price for their sinful deeds so that they can believe upon Jesus. So that they can look to Him. Did you know man has always wanted to worship something? Man's, it's built into us. We want to worship. It's built in us. We'll worship something, I guarantee you. And if we're not careful, we wind up worshiping the wrong things. It's kind of crazy that a man would build something out of sticks or wood that is less than himself and then fall down and worship something that is less than the one who created it. Isn't that nuts? But the desire is there, placed innate in man to worship. To worship God, the Father, the Creator of the heavens and earth. But we got one problem. He's a holy God. He's a sanctified God. And we can't get to Him unless we come through the only means that God created for us to have fellowship with Him. And that's through His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm still getting to God through Jesus. Still getting to God through. I don't have no fellowship with God except through His Son, Jesus Christ. That His Son Jesus is at His right hand side right now, making intercession for His saints.
Amen.
Every single one of you, right now, Jesus is praying for you. We don't understand it in our finite minds. We're thinking, how in the world can He do it? I mean, my goodness, He's better than Santa Claus. He can be all over the world in one night. But we don't understand the concept and the vastness of who God is. We don't have that concept down in our finite minds that God is great and He's all-powerful and He's all-knowing and He's omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time.
Yes.
And His presence is good.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
And if you're a child of God and you're trusting in what Christ has done on the cross for you, that good belongs to you.
Amen.
Not only does it belong to you because of an inheritance that you've been blood-bought, purchased by the blood of Jesus, brought into the family, but that birthright, that goodness belongs to you in a legal sense as well. Because you and I had a debt that we owed that we could not pay. I've heard people say, well, you'll pay the devil for that. Listen, we wasn't paying the devil for nothing.
Right.
And God didn't pay the devil for nothing. He didn't purchase our salvation from the devil.
Right.
The devil didn't hold the keys to our salvation. No. God paid His own sacrifice to Himself on that in your behalf,
right,
so that we would have eternal life.
Amen.
And that we can live in the goodness and the mercy and the grace of God.
Hallelujah.
I'm telling you, this world don't hold nothing for you.
No.
The one that's coming is going to be awesome. But I'm telling you that by the grace and the mercy and the goodness of what Christ did on the cross of Calvary, you can walk in that today.
Amen.
See, you and I live in an aspect of what Canaan land is.
Right.
I heard people say, well, Canaan land is heaven. Well, listen, Canaan land is a place in the Bible where the children of promise had to fight off the inhabitants of the land.
You have to fight in heaven.
You ain't got to fight in heaven. Heaven ain't going to be Canaan land. But if you're a child of God, you're living in Canaan land right now. Because every time you turn around, there's an inhabitant, there's a giant, there's a problem, there's a struggle, there's something coming along. And the test is that you and I will follow, will not mingle, but we'll follow Christ. We'll seek the things which are above. We'll let the blessing flow into our life. That we'll part ways from evil and sin and all the appearance of evil. That we'll part ways from that and walk in the mercy and the grace and the goodness of God the Father, who sent His Son, who filled and baptized us with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That the gifts of God flow into our lives and through our lives. Because you and I are light in a dark world. You and I are salt in a world that's become plain and bitter. You and I are seasoning in this world. People look at us, and if we're walking with Him and we're full of His Spirit and we're allowing His light to shine, people are going to look at us and they're going to see life. See, I believe in life, brother. I believe in life. I believe you need to speak life.
Yeah.
Amen. You need to speak life. You need to understand that everything that God does is life. I wish I could put it in words what I feel and what I see and what I've been seeing and what the Lord has been speaking down in my spirit. But God is great and He's awesome.
Amen.
And He's so great, it's so awesome that this world cannot contain all of Him.
Amen.
It can't contain all of Him. And I have to believe that if I'm looking, everywhere I look, I see the hand, I see His fingerprint. Lois's uncle passed away here last month, my mother-in-law's brother. And I was over there at their place a couple of weeks ago, painting my nephew's truck, and I walked outside the shop. And of course, his son's been struggling with some things and hurting, sudden death in the family. And Uncle Arnold lived to be 72 and had a real productive, happy life. Died the way he wanted to die. Went home to be with the Lord in his sleep. Just lay back down to bed and passed away in his sleep. But walking around the property over there while I was waiting on my brother-in-law and him to bring all the stuff, I thought, that's got to be hard on them, because everywhere you looked, I mean everywhere, you couldn't look anywhere on that property without there was something there that Uncle Arnold had his hand on. It's the same way with Lois and Lon's daddy. You go up there today, I mean, you can't walk around that place without you can't see the fingerprint, or you can't see a block or a piece of wood or something around there that Floyd put up. Everywhere you look, there's evidence of where he was.
Amen.
But that's on a human scale. The more I begin to look, Dwight, the more I see God's hand in everything around me. Everything. I see the hand of an almighty God who loves me.
Yeah.
Who loves me so much I don't even begin to even understand it. I used to read this passage over here that said, if you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. And of course, I was looking up in the heavens. You know, that's the way us charismatic Pentecostals do. We pray, and then we don't want to do nothing about it. We just want to stand back and watch the miracle of God drop it out of the sky. That's the way we do. But I found out the great miracle is not being lazy. Not a lazy Christian. I found out the great miracle is that every time you pray and you ask God for something, pop comes an opportunity in front of you. God says, all right, big boy, all right, little girl. Here's what you prayed for, but this is your opportunity. And I look at that every day in my life and I say, God, that's your fingerprint. God, that's your opportunity. God, you said seek the things which are above. Seek the God things. Seek the things that God has laid out there for you. If you'll ask Him, the opportunity will come. And then you'll see His fingerprint and His blessing in the middle of it. You'll see the blessing of what He is doing. Yes, seek the things which are above. People say, well, whenever I get up to heaven. Well, I'm not sure so much about up, down, what. Because I don't understand it all. But I do understand that whenever I'm in the presence of God, when the trump sounds and I'm given that immortal body, I don't care where it's at.
Amen.
As long as I'm in His presence.
Right.
But I can tell you something, folks, you're in His presence right now.
Amen.
You're in His mercy and His grace right now. Seek the things which are above really has to do more with seek the things of God in your life and recognize what He is doing in your life. If ye be risen with Christ. Now I talked a little bit about how that in the book of Romans, that when Christ died for man and your sin, that he died and He was buried. That you and I, because of faith in Christ and what He's done, that we were buried with Him. There's a line in there that says buried in baptism, but it doesn't have to do with water baptism. It has to do that we died in Christ. In other words, whenever God looks at you and I and we have displayed our faith in Christ and what He has done for us on the cross of Calvary, as far as when Christ died, we died with Him. But here's the good news. We didn't stay there. Neither did He stay there.
Right.
Because whenever Christ rose, because you put your faith in Christ and what He did on the cross, because Christ rose, you rose. Amen? I didn't say it right in English, I know. Get on to me over there. But by faith, because I believed in Christ, as far as God is concerned, when Christ died, I died with Him.
Yep.
But whenever He was raised from the dead, I was raised with Him. Not water baptism, not baptized in water. That doesn't do anything for me except it's a signal to the world that I've been born again and I've changed. But the real baptism is that I died in Christ and that Christ is in me and I am in here. Here's a good example of it. If you take a ship, well, I'll use a sponge for example. A sponge to me is better than a ship. If you take a sponge, and that's what that word baptize over there means, baptizo in the Greek. It literally means to be imbued with another substance, soaked. But if you take a sponge and you go home tonight and you run the sink full of water and you take that sponge And you lay it in there, that sponge will, well, it may float, but the fact of the matter is the sponge is in the water and the water's in the sponge. And when you place your faith in Christ and what He's done on the cross, you are in Christ and He is in you. You have been buried. You have been buried in the death of Christ by faith in what He's done for you on the cross. But you have also been risen with Christ. Because God raised Him from the dead. God raised Him from the dead. Therefore, by faith, you and I have been raised from the dead. Therefore, you and I are made a new man. This is why He tells us to mortify the flesh. To mortify the deeds of the body. Put off the old man. Put on the new man. Realize that you don't have to live back there anymore. You don't have to live in dead man's bones anymore. But you can live in a new life. You can put away the things of this world. And there's people, there's Christians that struggle with some things in the world. You know, you get saved, you get born again, and some things fall off and some things drag along. And then there's the fights. There's the struggles. But it's a fact that God's given you the victory through Christ and what He's done on the cross. And if you'll hang on to that and keep your faith in there, then one day you're going to wake up. It's going to be your day. It's going to be your day. You're going to get the victory over whatever it is that's against you because you've been risen with Christ.
Amen.
And you're going to put off another one and take on another one. Amen. And learn something about Christ. That's why I love the idea that I see His fingerprint in everything. I don't always understand why things are happening the way they're happening. But I know that God's going to show me. And I know that if I'm patient and I'll step back and wait on Him, that there's going to be a bigger blessing, a bigger spiritual blessing in the end than what I ever thought would ever take place. Amen. Do you believe that tonight? Do you really believe that?
Yes.
This is why He says, seek those things which are above. Seek the things of God.